Good morning. Thank you for having me here today. It is really lovely to be back here in Adelaide. And can I say that, and to be once again on Kaurna land, and I would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of this land, pay my respect to elders past and present, and also to any Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander people who might be here with us today. I'd like to thank Elizabeth and the team from ANMF for inviting me over here. Always like an excuse to come to Adelaide. And really what I'm going to be talking about today is about how, as nurses and midwives, we need to engage with policy processes. And of course, working in the Commonwealth Government, that is really what my life is about these days. And I'll give some examples during this talk of some of the areas where nurses and midwives are engaged or have an opportunity to be engaged that perhaps isn't being fully taken up at the moment. Really enjoyed Jill's talk, and I'd just like to reflect on a couple of aspects that Jill mentioned. For those of you that are interested, Joss de Blok, isn't it, from Birdsog, was actually in Australia at the APNA conference, I think it's 2 or 3 years ago, and certainly I know they've taken a keen interest in his work, and as have a number of us who are considering how in our delightful federated fee-for-service challenging system we could make that work. I also share some of Jill's frustration at times around how I think we often feel more disempowered than we really are, and for me that was exemplified when I was in New South Wales through the Essentials of Care project, where at a unit level people were able to make much more change than they thought they could once they were given some support and tools and processes by which to do it. So sometimes it's, I think, we don't know what we can do because we haven't been given some of those supports and processes to enable us to do that. I have to say these lights are terribly bright. And the last thing is, I recently, of course, have had experience on the other side of the bed when my mother was dying, and we were, first of all, in a large teaching hospital, and then she was moved to a smaller country hospital. It was the first time I've been into a hospital that has 24-hour visiting. We could go from 7 a.m. till 7 a.m. and the only thing we had to do was between certain hours was sign a book so that they knew how many other people were wandering around their place. That when we appeared in the ward, the staff would just say hello and we would get on with whatever we needed to do, and they would come when we needed them. Obviously, at times they were busy and we might have to wait. But it was a really nice experience, and I have to say it was fantastic to see nurses really engaging with people and really being sensitive to the needs of families. They did not know I was a nurse. Although, as you would know, it doesn't take long to give it away, even if you don't reveal. The questions we ask are a dead giveaway, particularly when it comes to pain relief and we start saying, what is in that syringe driver, and you need to put something more. But anyway, today we are talking about shaping the future. And because I'm old, I remember Star Trek well. And I used to love it, and I still love it. But I think sometimes shaping the future of healthcare is a little like Star Trek. We are, and in entering the world of policy, it can be a bit like that as well. And thinking about the future of health systems, though, we do need to be prepared to explore. We do need to look for new lands of opportunity, and we do need to recognise that our future is unlikely to look exactly the same as our past. And our capacity to look towards that future and not hold on to the entire past, but those bits that are good we should hold on to, but we really need to let go of a lot of stuff as well. And that, I think, is critical if we as professions are going to influence policy. Now, for those of you that don't know, and this is another old person, Cherry Ames, anybody read her? She's been everything, including chief nurse. So my role in the department at the Commonwealth level sits within what's called the Policy and Innovation, Strategic Policy and Innovation Group. So the majority of work in that group, as they call it, is around trying to think about the future of healthcare in the country, looking at what the Commonwealth Government's key and desires are and what they want to achieve, and turning that into policy or implementing that policy, and thinking about how we could deliver healthcare differently to make it better for all Australians. From my perspective, my key aim there is to try and facilitate engagement with nurses and midwives on these matters. I think nurses and midwives have an enormous understanding about what goes on in healthcare, but what's important for the community. The engagement and the relationship that nurses and midwives have with people in receipt of care is very privileged, but it also gives you an enormous insight into what matters to them about healthcare and how do we get that voice heard in developing policy. As you would know, we have three ministers, Minister Hunt, Minister White and Minister Gillespie. They all have different aspects of healthcare and so we engage with them on a regular basis. So I just want to talk a little bit about policy and what is policy and how do we engage. So if you think about it, look, you can go to any textbook and you will find a definition. This is but one. But some of the major government policies we've seen over the years in this country is tobacco, which has been an extremely successful one. Dare I say a hard-fought one. We've only recently been in the courts internationally over the plain packaging. So it is a never-ending fight to maintain some of these policies. In other areas, there's work now happening around obesity. And of course, one of the major changes from the Commonwealth perspective is the introduction of healthcare homes. This represents one of the most significant changes in that sector for many, many years. And it provides a real opportunity to look at different ways of doing things. And also, it's not just about how the care gets delivered and organised, it is also changing the way the funding flows. So this is a really major change, enormously complex and extremely challenging for those more directly involved. And it will be slow. And some of these things are very slow. It doesn't, you know, always happen at the speed that we might like. But one of the things to think about is, so how do ideas become? When is their time? How do we know when the time is right? How do priorities get identified and translated into policy? Why do these sorts of things get on people's agendas? And it's important to think about and understand some of those processes. So I'm not sure if you're familiar with John Kingdon's work, but what he talks about that there are three streams that determine why some problems are chosen over others for policy development. And so he talks about the problem stream, and they're the policy issues which are seen to require attention. So they are the objective, there are no objective indicators to say which ones are going to become the ones that get attention. But often it's based on how they are framed, how they are presented to the key decision maker. And, you know, there are heaps and heaps of things in this world we could be working on. There are lots of problems in healthcare that we might like to see get attention. So how is it that certain ones get up? And part of that then is the policy stream, which is about, is there a solution to the problem that you've identified? So that's where that you start to see policy. So, you know, when we have issues, well, we do tend to move from issue to issue very quickly. And we know that getting really good solutions to key policy problems takes time. These are not things that you can develop quickly. And he describes all these different ideas about how we might fix certain policy problems as the policy primeval soup. And so we get all different people playing in this space, coming up with ideas and saying we should do this, we should do that. And things get worked up to a point, people do a bit of work on it, they might move on to another one, someone might say don't waste your time on that. And then you get the politics stream. And so that's where you have policy makers when they have the motive and the opportunity to turn it into policy. So they've got to pay attention to the problem, they've got to be receptive to the proposed solution, and then if it goes along with what perhaps their perceptions are or their views or some of their own agendas, then they will move forward to actually implement. So what you see happening is that these three things are all going on their own, and at a point in time they converge and they come together, and that's when the policy window opens. Now these don't necessarily open all that often, but you need to be ready for when they open. So it's often a very short time, and as I said, it can be relatively infrequent that these might appear. And if you miss that opportunity, do you wait for another one? Well, yes, you can, depending on what it is. I can give you a couple of examples. One, when I was in New South Wales was one of the, well, I think it might have been the last jurisdiction to move out of the apprenticeship model for enrolled nurse education. Now, I'd put up a proposal around that, and you know, we'd worked it up, and we were told, no, we're not doing that, we're not doing that. So I said to my team, well, I'm just going to sit that in my drawer here. Anyway, 6 months down the track, I get a phone call from them upstairs. Did you tell me you could save X amount of dollars with enrolled nursing? I said, yes. Good, bring it up here. So out it comes out of the drawer and up I go. And it was implemented. So things don't always happen in the way you plan, but you need to be ready to go with it when it presents, when the opportunity presents. Another one of these which I'll use here is around when the nurse practitioner role was first being put into place. And as you know, the first ones were in New South Wales. So the problem, well, attention was drawn to a policy problem. And if you go back and read the early days and how this came about, the problem that was identified was that we did not have equitable access to healthcare for underserved populations in rural and remote. So at that time, nurse practitioners were framed as being a solution to solve access to healthcare in rural and remote areas. So there was research drawing on international experience to support the role and that this would be achievable for the profession. And then there reached a point in time where the policymakers had the motive and they had the opportunity. Now, one of these was that there was a minister who was interested in this and wanted to improve things in rural and remote New South Wales. So he was willing to stick his neck out, basically, to get this policy through government. And so he supported the implementation of the role, and the rest, as they say, is history. It wasn't perfect. It wasn't everything we wanted, and there is still a lot of work to do. And it took something like 10 or 20 years to get there. So I think it is salient to learn the lessons of history at times, but to remind ourselves that, you know, we have had some wins. The other big policy win we had was when the entire profession, and it's probably the only time in my working life that I've seen this happen, came together for goals in nursing education back in, Rosemary, you would remember the year better than me. Were you at RCNA then? But RCNA, ANMF came together and, no, you weren't, sorry. It was before you. That's right, I'm ageing, it's terrible of me. I was working as a nurse in the Northern Territory and came down for, we had a major meeting at Moonee Valley Racecourse, and came up with the goals in nursing education. There was a clear political campaign conducted, and over that next few years, the changes were achieved. And I know in New South Wales in 85, they had a letter writing campaign, they had everything going. And that was where the profession and the organisations that lead it came together to really drive a major policy initiative. And part of that was that they understood the politics of the time. And that's the other really critical thing if you're going to work in the policy space, you need to understand politics, both big P and little P. So obviously I get to play with some big P politics at times, but the little P politics is all the conversations you have. It's all the things you do in your various groups and the way you frame things and the way that then gets fed into community and the way the population starts to think about issues. We all have opportunities to play in those sort of political spaces. So today we'll just talk about, you know, what is politics, and as I said, it is often associated with government. It applies, as I said, to all aspects of life. You'll think about your families at Christmas. Is that not an example of political activity? Where are we going to go? Who's going to put it on? Who gets to cook? Are we doing gifts? Aren't we doing gifts? Auntie Mary can't come and Auntie Jane wants to and we don't want her. Whatever. So all of that is a political activity. We shouldn't kid ourselves that we don't do it all the time. There's often a lot of negative images, I think, associated with politics, but it is something that we have to engage in and we cannot avoid it. So I'm just going to share with you quickly today what I call the cliche guide to politics and policy. So the first thing is you need to look at the big picture. You need to take yourselves out of your own little space and your own little thing that you're thinking about and think about the big picture. You need to do your homework. You need to make sure you well understand all the various aspects of whatever this issue is that you're trying to influence or that you want to engage on. Nothing ventured, nothing gained. If you don't give it a go, you're not going to get anywhere. Sometimes you'll meet failure and sometimes you'll meet success. When it doesn't work, learn from it and move on to the next thing. Sometimes it's about getting a toe in the door. Sometimes if you can just get that first step, you can then find that you can push through with some of the other steps that you need to make. But you've got to get that first step made. You need to understand who your allies and supporters are. Does somebody else need something that you can help them out with? And if you help them out with that, then as a quid pro quo, you get them to help you out in achieving your issue. Walk a mile in another's shoes. You well need to understand things from the other person's perspective. So the person that you're trying to influence, you need to think about it from their perspective. This, I think, is one of our big challenges at times for nursing and midwifery. We well understand our language, we understand why we might want something, and we talk about it that way to a policymaker, and it's like, what? And we need to learn the language that pushes their buttons, basically. What is the way that we need to frame our issues so that it meets their understanding and fits in with their world? Because they're not going to come and sit in our world. You need to strike while the iron is hot, and that's about windows of opportunity. Sometimes you get an opportunity, you need to be prepared to take it. Even if you haven't got all the T's crossed and all the I's dotted, you might only be 80% of the way there with what you want to do, but this is your opportunity. Get in there and fix the other 15 or 20%. Read between the lines. Often there is other messaging going on and you need to be very astute when you're reading, well, not just reading, but speaking with people, that they may not be saying directly to you what some issue is, but if you are listening carefully, you will understand that there is something else going on here that I need to find out about. Sometimes we don't get everything, and sometimes it is better to accept half a loaf is better than none and build on that. And in a way, to some extent, nurse practitioners are a bit like that. We didn't get everything we wanted, but we got a fair bit of it. And we probably would have been worse off if we'd said, no, we're going to hold out for the perfect world. The perfect doesn't come along very often. And Rome wasn't built in a day. These things take time. Policy work is slow work. It is not quick work. You have to be in it for the long haul. If you're not prepared to play the long game and be in it for the long haul, I would suggest you might want to do some other things. So I'll just talk now about a few big policy issues that are certainly of interest to the Commonwealth, but which I think you should also be interested in, and some of the work that we've been doing, particularly in conjunction with the jurisdictional chief nurses. The first one is antimicrobial resistance. Antimicrobial resistance is probably the greatest threat to healthcare that we have seen in our generations. The gradual increase in the number of resistance that's growing around the world is quite scary. And I think that it is very much on the agenda of the World Health Organization and very much on the agenda of all countries around the world. I attended the World Health Assembly in May in Geneva, and this subject was one of major discussion amongst all of the countries present there. And we have a lot of work going on in Australia, but it does require action everywhere, and we are a part of that action that is required. If we don't deal with some of these issues, then we risk the success that we currently see with surgery and things like chemotherapy will be put at risk. The cost of healthcare is going to increase even more than it's already increasing. And we're going to see people not just staying in hospital or health services longer, but people dying because of the ineffective nature of some of our antibiotics. We already have examples of multi-resistant TB and the challenge that that presents. There's currently globally 480,000 people developing multi-resistant TB every year. And we are now starting to see drug resistance complicating the fight against HIV and malaria. And I mean, you can just imagine if we can't overcome this issue, where we will end up. The World Health Organization has a global action plan on AMR, And of interest, only 5 new classes of antibiotics have come onto the market in recent years. And none of them are targeting gram-negative bacteria. So part of the conversation is about improving and increasing the level of research into new antibiotics. For the industry that makes antibiotics, there's not really been a strong driver. They're making plenty out of the existing ones. So it's about working with industry to increase their research and to look at how we can get new antibiotics on the market. In Australia, we have a national antimicrobial resistance strategy. And throughout the world and in Australia, we talk about One Health, because this isn't just about the part of healthcare we're involved in. And the Australian plan does engage with food and agriculture, because as you know, antibiotics get used in a whole pile of areas in both the food and agricultural sector. So the Australian AMR strategy actually has brought together those various groups, and we are taking a One Health approach. There's now an implementation plan, and the other thing is that we, through the Commission for Safety and Quality, we have an antimicrobial use and resistance monitoring scheme. So actually, I think the most recent ORA data was just published, because there's been a bit in the media about some of the results. So what is it that you as nurses and midwives can do in this space? I think it's interesting that only 1% of nursing and midwifery literature talks about AMR. As nurses and midwives, you prepare, administer and prescribe antibiotics. And, you know, right across the whole health system, we have nurses and midwives engaged in these areas. We need to educate the community better about antibiotics, how they work, what they need to do, when they need them. And I think the other role that a lot of nurses and midwives have, you have a lot of conversations with the general community. Your neighbour pops in and says, oh, you know, I feel a bit down, I think I better go to the doctor and get some antibiotics. Well, there's an opportunity to say, do you really need antibiotics? You know, if it's a cold, it doesn't need an antibiotic. To your own parents, to your children, to yourself. So I think that we have informal capacity, but I think we also need to be formally engaged in some of the other work happening. And of course, the other thing is the work around the surgery safety checklist, and that's been nationally agreed. So in some of these things, we have a role. And in looking at surgical prophylaxis and the use of antibiotics in those, working with surgeons and hospitals and other pharmacists about what is the appropriate use, when is it right to use prophylaxis, do we really need it, and how do we better manage these things? And even in just the way you administer antibiotics yourselves. So some of the areas we have is through patient management plans, the input that you have into those, assessing the risk and of transmitting infection, talking to people in your care about those things. Our own infection control standards, making sure that we practice very effectively from an infection control perspective so that we don't spread disease, and obviously where there is multi-resistant organisms present, that we really reduce the risk of those being transmitted. Medication management, a major area, ensuring that people get the right antibiotics at the right time by the right route. You know the 5 rights probably better than I do these days. And but also in talking to people about this is what your antibiotic's for, you need to do this, this is how long the course is, this is what it will mean for you and why you need to have this course of therapy. Collaborating with other members of the healthcare team around the use of antibiotics, but whether or not certain patients need them or don't. Educating ourselves and educating others better in this space around antimicrobial resistance. And participating in surveillance systems, making sure that we are getting good data and understanding of what's happening. And obviously correctly disposing of used antimicrobials. I'm now just going to talk briefly about 2 pieces of work which myself with my colleagues from the jurisdictions, the Chief Nursing and Midwifery Officers in the 2 in all the jurisdictions have been engaged in, and through which we are also working with the Nursing and Midwifery Board of Australia. So in March 2017, we held a 2-day symposium with invited attendees. The day 1 was looking at advanced practice, And day two was looking at nurse midwife prescribing. And my colleague Lisa Nissen, who's going to speak to you after this, was one of our keynote speakers, and I'm really glad I'm speaking before her because she is so good. And she has been a really key player and key advisor for us on the prescribing issues, and is going to continue to work with us on that, which is great. But we know that advanced practice roles can provide really positive impact on healthcare delivery, as well as providing opportunities for nurses. And so there's a lot of potential there. And also with the reform that's high on government agendas all around the country and at the national level, we need to make sure we've got these things and nursing and midwifery best positioned as we can to ensure that we're making the greatest contribution we can to those reforms, but also to take advantage of some of the opportunities that might present. So one of these was to, the advanced practice one was really about strengthening the understanding of advanced nursing practice, because I don't know about you, but if you read the definitions on the NMBA website, I'm not left much clearer. And the other one, and there is a lot of confusion in the literature as well, and in conversation with people. And the other was to examine the role or potential role for expanded models of nurse midwife prescribing in the Australian context. So the NMBA, particularly on the prescribing front, was a key partner in this piece of work. Now the reports from these 2 days will be sent out to the participants, hopefully on Friday when I get back to the office, and be made more broadly available next week, because the chief nurses and midwives met with the board last week, and we've got their agreement with what's come out, and we've got some agreement about the next steps, which I'll share with you. So in terms of advanced practice, there was agreement out of the day that advanced practice is a level of practice, it's not necessarily a role. So there are many roles which have advanced practice embedded within them. The most obvious one is nurse practitioner. And one of the other critical things is that advanced practice is more than the acquisition of technical skills. So because I learn a couple of new technical activities, it doesn't mean that I'm necessarily advanced in my practice. In actual fact, I may just be starting to practice at full scope. And it's really important for us to well understand when we're reaching full, when we're practicing to the full extent of our scope, and when we are moving more into an advanced practice arena. There was certainly general agreement that the NMBA definitions require review for clarity. And at our meeting last week, they have agreed that they are going to look at the definitions. And we did say to them, could we just have one definition, please? Because most of us are very confused and can't get our head around advanced practice nursing and advanced nursing practice. Exactly what are they? And that there was a lot of support that we should be utilising the model encompassing the 5 domains described in the contemporary Australian research based on the strong model undertaken by Gardner, Gardner and Duffield. A large part of that research was actually funded by the ANMF, and we wouldn't have it without that generous support. But that it was, there was a general agreement that those 5 domains well represent what in this country we should be considering is advanced practice. And there was conversation about what should the educational requirements at a baseline level be for advanced practice. So the 5 domains, for those of you that don't know them off the top of your head, and I've got them written down here because I always can remember 4 of the 5, never the 5. So there's direct comprehensive care, which is really your clinical component. And this day was only talking about advanced practice in the clinical area, not in education and management. Supportive systems, education, research and publication and professional leadership. And basically, in order to be considered an advanced practice, there was general agreement you need to be high across all 5 domains. So to be practicing at that level, you should be able to identify that you're performing at a high level across those domains. The prescribing day was very well informed by 2 presentations from Lisa. And we then, obviously, there was a fair bit of conversation and discussion. Some of the underpinning things were that this was about enhancing access to medicines for the Australian community and improving the person's experience. It was about efficiency and cost effectiveness, workforce flexibility, and played into the hospital avoidance space. And that what we were hoping is that the outcomes would inform the regulatory framework to support RNRM prescribing models in this country, give guidance to employers and guidance to the professions about how this would look. I have to say, the conversation on the day was fantastic. People engaged in both days in a really open way. They put aside some of their, for some people, very long-held views. And we saw people really challenging each other and challenging themselves about how we as professions act in this space and where do we fit. There was agreement that we need to be person-centred, we need to ensure safety, so quality use of medicines and safety, that we want a nationally consistent approach, that it needs to be relevant to communities, but the profession and health systems, of course, needs to be accessible and that it needs to be collaborative because we don't function as a complete island and we need to work with other members of the team. And so the outcome of that piece of work is that, as of last week, the Nursing and Midwifery Board of Australia and the Chief Nurses and Midwives, and with Lisa as a member, have now formed a working group to look at what the model may look like. That will obviously need to be consulted upon broadly across the nursing and midwifery professions and healthcare providers, and there'll be a great bunch of interested parties, in order to reach agreement. We have a deadline on this because the endorsement for RIPEN goes in November 2018, and there are two jurisdictions that use that endorsement. So we need a clearer model for nurse midwife prescribing in this country to be ready to roll off the line by October 18, which really means it needs to be finished about 4 to 6 months before that, because it will have to go through a pile of government processes in order to get approved. So it's a very short time frame, but certainly I think I can say, certainly for the chief nurses, and I would say for the NMBA, we're very keen to get this progressed and to get a model that works for Australia, for nurses and midwives, and that will enhance healthcare for the Australian community. So I'd just like to finish by saying, in terms of things like this, we need to connect with the political and social agenda of the day. And so certainly things like prescribing and even advanced practice are very much being framed in what are some of the key health agendas that we can contribute to if we have nurses and midwives doing these things. We need to recognise that there'll be differing needs for the individual. I, as a nurse or a midwife, might want to achieve A or B, but that may not be fit well with the organisation, or it might look a bit different for the organisation, so we need to understand that and how do we position ourselves. We need to have continued engagement. These sorts of things are work over time. You've got to be continually engaging with the relevant players and keeping them on the journey with you. You need to be able to show the benefits and the operational attributes, and with advanced practice, we had a lovely example from the Executive Don of the Royal Children's, where they're working through their whole organisation, identifying where they have roles that incorporate advanced practice at the moment and how they're going to manage all that better to provide both better care for the children in that health service, but also provide opportunities for nurses to perform to their fullest capability and to have career opportunities. And we need to look at the ability to have local adaptation. But I think one of the key things in these spaces is just remember, behold the turtle. It doesn't make progress without sticking its head out. You need to be prepared to put your head above the parapet every so often. Strategically, of course, you know, just bob up and down. But at times, you may need to stick your neck out. But, and I'll leave you with the words of Mahatma Gandhi, the difference between what we do and what we are capable of doing would suffice to solve most of the world's problems. We have many of the answers and we have the capability. Sometimes we need to give ourselves the permission to have a go. And my staff would not forgive me if I didn't give you the contact details. Thank you.